The third leg of this Turkish issue is their very troubled relationship with their Kurdish minority. Mm-hmm. As someone said just yesterday, hey, the good news is Turkey is bombing. The bad news is they're bombing the Kurds. Mm-hmm. We've got to get them in the game against ISIS, get them unfocused on the Kurdish issue and unfocused for the moment on Assad.
We have been told in no uncertain terms by the experts who know such things, if we do not help the Kurdish fighters in Iraq, then we are both foolish and doomed to failure. But it's a tough bill to sell the American public after years of fighting and little more than failure to win a war. What is it about these people we do not or cannot understand? Welcome to Midpoint. He grew up in a military family on his way to becoming a New York Times best-selling author, and his latest book is The Miracle of the Kurds, the remarkable story of hope reborn in northern Iraq, Stephen Mansfield. Stephen, thank you so much for being here today.
It's great to be with you.
Stephen, knowing what you know about the Kurds, your intimate knowledge of them as well, would you agree with those folks that say, quite frankly, when we talk about boots on the ground, those boots are there in the Kurds, and we are kidding ourselves, and we are simply doing ourselves a disservice if we don't go in, help them as much as we can, and make them the winners in this conflict?
You've said it very well. Without the Kurds, we are not going to defeat ISIS. The Iraqi army has imploded and left its Western weapons on the field. Turkey is more interested in bombing its own citizens, its own Kurds, than they are in engaging right there on their border. Syria, as we know, the Syrian army is either distracted or a myth. And so the Kurds are the most viable, effective fighting force against ISIS in the field. And yet, U.S. foreign policy has largely been based upon dealing with Baghdad and hoping that Baghdad deals with the Kurds rather than us dealing with the Kurds directly. And that's just going to have to stop.
Why is that simply wrong?
Well, the reality is that the Kurds have endured a double embargo for many years. Baghdad is really no fan of the Kurds for the most part. Again, we've lived through the Saddam years. We've lived through years of oppression before that. Saddam killed almost a million Kurds. He killed 15,000 in one day in 1988 in Halabja by gassing them. We turned, for the most part, a blind eye to a lot of that. And so now we see the Kurds, since the advent of the no-fly zone in the early 1990s, have built a democratic, fair society with very libertarian investment laws, foreign investment laws, allowing foreign investment in huge, huge amounts. And so they are there in the belly of the Middle East, a pro-democracy, pro-Western, and largely pro-Israel society that's yearning to be free. And we insist on dealing with their enemies in order to deal with them. It's just not going to work. They've proven themselves, they've passed the test, and it's time for us to arm them directly and stand with them.
When you talk about pro-democracy, pro-American, and pro-Israeli, there are so many people who would say, how can that possibly be in that area of the country where everything you're talking about right now runs completely counter to everything we know? How have they managed to survive, I guess, would be the number one thing. And number two, how have they managed then to become so powerful, militarily at least, or at least as a fighting force?
Well, as a fighting force, they have a long and storied history. They were some of the treasured warriors during the Ottoman Empire back before World War I. They have a martial culture in which they teach the young how to fight. They have unusual ways that I've seen up in the mountains of Kurdistan where they teach the young to shoot on one foot and then shoot on the other foot and then shoot left and right-handed. And all of this is part of their normal indoctrination of the young. So they are fierce fighters. They have been the bodyguards to some of Europe's royal families. They have a very strong martial culture married to a very poetic soul. And so they've survived largely through their own wisdom, their own cunning, and through their martial skills. But Saddam almost wiped them out, and had there not been a no-fly zone that kept his choppers from dropping sarin and mustard gas upon them back in the early 90s, they might very well have been wiped out. From that time, they have built a very democratic society. People don't know, for example, that within the Kurdish government, there's a Christian department, there's an Yazidi department. Women sit on the Supreme Court. Women command troops. It's a very moderate form of Islam, and this is part of the reason that ISIS is going after them.
When you talk about going in, and so many people have talked about arming the Kurds, giving them the weapons that they need, it is no secret that many Americans right now are afraid to do anything to put the weapons into the hands of anybody in the Middle East, because we have seen those weapons come back against us sooner or later at one time. What is it that we can do to allay the fears of the American people to say, wait a minute, It's not a problem here. They won't rise up against us. These are actually our friends. It's tough to get that through, Stephen. It's been a long time coming, but people can't see that.
Well, and again, our problem is an ignorance of history, and I'm not speaking down to my own people. I'm a very patriotic American. But we don't know that the Kurds have stood with us when we've not stood with them, time after time. For example, I know I'm going back a bit in history, but in Halabja in 1988, some of the gas dropped upon the Kurds was from American companies. And yet the Kurds have continued to be American allies. After the Gulf War, the Kurds rose up against Saddam, and they were massacred for it. That was at the urging of George H.W. Bush, the first Bush, and yet the Kurds moved on and forgave and are still our allies. So they have proven themselves in the field. They have proven themselves loyal allies. They have proven themselves committed to democracy and really a Western-style orientation, even on human rights. We're talking about arming Mujahideen militias in Syria. We arm Baghdad. Why wouldn't we arm the people who have provided the most signal victories against ISIS and who have proven themselves over the decades? It's just a case that makes itself if we know the history of the Kurds.
Is this just then an arrogant Obama administration and the people that are around him right now who refuse to confront what you're saying right here and to understand it and to believe that that's the way to get it done?
Well, it is arrogance in the sense that they are committed to a failed policy. They insist upon a unified Iraq. What they may not understand is that most of Iraq is Arab, but the Kurds are not Arab. The Kurds are more ethnically Iranian. I mean that only in the ethnic sense. So they have been, since after World War I, the Kurds have been superglued into an Iraqi nation in which they did not fit, where they were usually persecuted. Now they have an independent region. We ought to at least encourage that, if not encourage nationhood, and understand that they are opposed by many in the Middle East precisely because of this heritage they enjoy and because of their moderation as Muslims. So again, I say they've proven themselves. It's time to stand with them. And I don't know what the Obama administration understands or what they don't, but insisting on dealing with the Kurds only through Baghdad is a failed policy and may cause a tremendous ISIS victories in the north.
The book again is called The Miracle of the Kurds, a remarkable story of hope reborn in northern Iraq. Stephen Mansfield is the author. Thank you so much for giving us a little insight into what goes on in that area of Iraq. I hope we get a chance to speak again soon.
I look forward to it. Thank you.
Thank you. Later on this hour, the task facing American Muslims seeking peace is to step out and confront the issue. But are they truly ready and up to the task? And after the break, Congressman Patrick Meehan joins us to tackle the issue of banning all travel from Western African nations. That's coming up right here on Midpoint.
President Obama will name former White House aide Ron Klain as America's Ebola czar. Klain will be the administration's new point man on U.S. efforts to contain and control the virus. Meanwhile, another worker from Texas Health Presbyterian is being isolated aboard a cruise ship today. That person boarded for the seas before learning about new monitoring rules from the CDC. And Carnival Cruise Line says, quote, at no point in time has the individual exhibited any symptoms or signs of infection. In other news, in Nigeria, hundreds of schoolgirls kidnapped by the militant group Boko Haram will be released. The Nigerian government reached a truce with the Islamic group earlier today. And finally, in the Caribbean, Hurricane Gonzalo is barreling towards Bermuda right now. It got downgraded to a Category 3 storm, but it's still packing 125-mile-per-hour winds. We'll keep you posted on that as well. I'm Olga Villaverde. We'll have another update for you at the top of the hour. We hope to see you then. We'll be right back.